Everybody straight?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm going to start. So I am Sharmell McMillan, and this is the sixth episode of It Is What It Is, How Men Think, talking love, life, relationships, and everything in between. And a little bit of background, I produced and created a radio show about 7-8 years ago called It Is What It Is. And I decided to reboot it as a Zoom show so you can see who I'm talking to. And so this is the platform where men tell it like it is, and it always is what it is, uncut. And so I'm glad that you all could join us tonight. The topic tonight is 99 problems. You know, Jay-Z said he got 99 problems, but it ain't one. So we're talking 99 problems tonight. But first, let me introduce my guest. The first guest, he is probably one of the coolest, most sincere souls I've met in recent years. And I love his mantra, God said it and so it is. He hails from Memphis, Tennessee, isn't it? Memphis, Tennessee, is that it?
Absolutely.
Memphis, Tennessee, I would guess so. So, and he, we crossed paths in LA constantly, and he was just always so super cool. And then you never know who's watching you and paying attention. I saw him backstage after a Tori Hart show. And so he came to me. I told Tori, she got to meet you. And she said, she knows everybody. So whatever she tells you, listen to it because she gives great advice. And so I didn't know he knew I gave great advice, but thank you, love. And so he has been seen on Unmasked, Sidewalk Superheroes, I Got the Hook Up Too. He's also been seen on Lost Souls Cafe, Off the Chain with my brother Rodney Perry on Bounce, and Laugh Mobs, We Got Next on Aspire. And he's a member of the Purple and Gold. I'm the Pink and Green, Omega Sci Fi.
How y'all doing, man? I'm glad to be here. I heard she can cook, so I just want to let
her know.
Her heart was in Baltimore. She definitely didn't invite us over to eat nothing.
You know, I stay so busy now, but I'm gonna get to my cooking in a minute. I'm sure somebody's gonna say something. but let me introduce my second guest. He is one of my personal favorite comedians, hands down. I've been in the entertainment industry 25 years, and so I think I know a little bit about what's hot. And so he makes it look effortless. He's been in the game for 25 years in this industry. He is definitely one of the best to ever do it. For the past 15 years, he has toured the country with one of the original kings of comedy, Cedric the Entertainer. He's been on BET and HBO on several shows like The Monique Show, Def Comedy Jam, BET Comic View. Cedric Entertainer Presents, Platinum comedy series, Starting Lineup. He was also in the hilarious movie, Johnson Family Vacation, alongside Steve Harvey, Vanessa Williams, Bow Wow, and Cedric himself. He hails from Mississippi, Jackson, Mississippi, matter of fact, J.J. Williamson.
J.J. in the building. What up, Sean?
What up, baby?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Ham.
So my last guest, I have to tell you why he's so dear to me before I introduce him. Like I said, this is 25 years in the entertainment industry for me. And there have been people along the way who have planted seeds that have changed my outlook on how I move. And so I met him at the turning point of that 25 years, about 20 years ago. And so I started out in the mid 90s producing shows and working on tours with Def Comedy Jam, comedians and different various tours, Canadian Mist. And I also was the operations manager for the Comedy Connections back in the day. And so I met him when musicians started coming to me and saying they wanted management, but I didn't know anything about the music industry. So my reputation around the comedy industry was she's real smart and she knows business. So, because I had just finished my master's in business management and my master's in engineering, but I have a concentration in contract law. So I was getting contracts straight for people back in the day. So I met with him, and my only friend in the music industry was Kevin Peck at the time. And so he had this group called Drew Hill. And so I called Kevin and I said, Kevin, I think I need a demo for these music artists. And he said, I'll hook you up with some producers. I didn't know he's going to hook me up with some of the baddest boys in Baltimore. So I, and they were producing for everybody at the time. So his spirit was so ominous and he seemed like a gangster. So I was scared of him, but he smiled at some point. And so I was like, I think I can confide in him. I don't know how I made that jump, but I said, I can confide in him. I said, I'm scared. I don't know anything about music artists. And so he said, there's something about your personality. And clearly, you know, the right people where they will do favors for you in a heartbeat. So it's not always what you know, it's who you know. And I can see God has surrounded you and it's going to carry you throughout your career. People are going to see your light before you say anything. And so that changed how I move. And so I thank you. But beyond being my friend, he got a couple of credits. He has been in the entertainment industry for over 30 years. He is one of the most humble music geniuses I know. He's an actor, singer, songwriter, producer extraordinaire. He plays at least 7 or 8 instruments. His talents and musical gifts have been heard everywhere, from the Basement Boys back in the day with Crystal Waters and her hit single, Gypsy Woman, She's Homeless, to Nona Hendrix, Babyface, and Drew Hill, to just to name a few. He has performed all over the world, and he is currently the minister of music for Israel Baptist Church in Baltimore. My friend, my brother, my partner in crime, Randy Fruity Roberts.
Fellas, y'all got to get that food. I'm telling you.
I'm telling you, man. I'm about to book me a flight right now.
Yeah, last time I came to see you, it was like 5, 6, 7 years ago. I think I bought barbecue chicken and fried fish and macaroni and cheese with lump crab and ginger cabbage. Oh, we threw down.
Yeah,
so back in the day, like to bring you and Memphis and JJ in, back in the day, how my cooking came into play, I think everybody on Def Jams has stopped through my house at some point. But when I started working with the musicians, and I eventually became, partner with Kevin Peck on Drew Hill, and he had the management company, EMG. On the weekends, we had these music houses of all these different producers who are now multi-platinum and doing the daggone thing. You'll probably see them in upcoming weeks. But I would cook on Sundays and have Sunday dinner at 410 Music, which was a huge, studio. And so I would cook and have Sunday dinner. And so all the producers would come from the different studio houses and have dinner. And so sometimes I would come up to Baltimore to work all night, or I was going to stay up in Baltimore at the label, because we had suites above the label. And I would cook and I would call the guys and say, are y'all hungry? I know you're hungry. So I would just bring food when I came up to Baltimore, because I knew they were in the studio just making music all night, hadn't eaten, weren't taking care of themselves. So I was vice president of marketing, but I was also chef. So that's the connection.
Oh, that's what's up, boy. You gave me the history.
Yes, she did. See, they don't make it like that no more. They don't make them like that no more.
It was good times. Yes, babe. What'd you say?
I got one though, thank God.
Your wife is beautiful. So let me figure out how I want to kick off this show, because I got some real ones. This is episode 6. And every now and then I revisit something because I want to know how y'all feel about it and what you're going to say. So I remember on my first show, I touched on this topic, and hold on, my phone is acting crazy. Okay. I touched on this topic, and I think you can't be on social media. You can't be in any type of platform with women and the word liar not come up when talking about men. So my question is, how do you all feel about that narrative that men are liars? And is it true? Or do women just hear what they want to hear?
Anybody? They both.
Both?
I'm going to be real. We both, we get away with some stuff, man. But, women, y'all will manipulate the story and make blow it up way more than it really is and everything, man. So, that social media is a dangerous game to play with and everything, man. On both sides, though. On both sides. It's a dangerous game to play with. So you got to be careful, especially when, I'm in a happily great marriage and everything, man. So, my wife ain't going to play that.
You tell the truth now.
I got to sleep in that bed. My wife know how to get up without making noise, so I ain't finna mess with her.
Working with that knife on your throat.
Yeah, for real. So I ain't messing with her, man.
Let me tell you this, y'all. This is one of the things that I think, and from what I have experienced personally, growing up, I'm 51 now.
Me too.
as a boy, one of the things that I noticed, I realized that at the end of the day, now hear me, let me finish saying what it is that I'm saying.
Okay.
At the end, I'm not talking about just being mischievous and just outright lying, things of that nature. You know that guys can do that bull crap, or some men can do that. Some boys do it, some men do it. This is the part that I'm talking about. I remember at one point in time in my life, at the end of the day, I never wanted to hurt the woman that I was with.
Right.
So here was my thought process. Now, it doesn't mean that it was right, but this was my truth, my thought process. Mm-hmm. So I began thinking, you know, at the end of the day, the last thing I want to do is hurt this woman. So in my mind, I'm thinking, if I tell her everything, everything will hurt her. So what I would do, I would tell her some of it, but not all of it, only to find out that that's a half truth and it's still not really totally what's going on or what happened.
Mm-hmm.
In the midst of that, only to find out that at the end of the day, with you all having women's intuition, being nosy and wanting to be detectives due to things that you all do, a lot of I mean, it is, that's the show. It is what it is.
Right. It is what it is.
What I learned was this: in doing so, you still found out what the whole truth was. Now you're mad and you're hurt anyway, which is what we were trying to protect you from in the first place. Because if we really, really care about you, we really love you, the last thing we want to do is to see you hurt, and especially to be hurt by us. Right. So what I did, I came up with this particular motto and saying, if you really don't want to know, don't ask. Number two, here it is. I'd rather tell you the truth and hurt your feelings than tell you a lie and hurt your heart. It's easier for you to get over hurt feelings than a hurt heart. And at the end of the day, you will still at least respect me. You may not like it, but you will respect me because you have, you know what, man, you know what, Fruity Randy, he did tell me.
It was wrong, but he did tell me.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't have to find out about this on the street or social media. Somebody didn't have to throw it up in my face. And now I'm embarrassed. And now I got to go back to him and ask him, what in the world, what the hell is going on? How could you do this? So, you know, so that's if you really don't know what, if you really don't want to know what the dress looks like on you, don't ask me.
Right.
Because I'm going to tell you the truth. Yeah. Now, it's not what you say, but it's how you say it. But don't get mad or upset if I give you my truth and if not what you wanted to hear.
Yeah, yeah. Especially if you ask for it.
Right.
Right.
I mean, at the end of the day, I'm saying that he did a good job of still lying.
Y'all lying.
I mean, I ain't never seen nobody. I started believing him. He did such a fantastic job of making it really okay to lie. But the old saying is, if you're looking for trouble, you're gonna find trouble. Even if it's not trouble, it's just gonna look for trouble because your mindset is already on trouble. Because your mindset is looking for something you ain't got no business in the first place. So I think it starts with the mindset. So if the mindset thinks a man cheating or thinks a man lying, now you looking through his phone, now you stalking him and all this old stuff.
Right.
Well, you might end up seeing something you don't want to see. And it might not be what it looks like.
Right.
It just so happened your mindset is already in a negative place. So he can see an old friend and end up giving her a hug in the middle of you stalking him and you just come out of nowhere. I told you, you hear it with this girl. But all the time, they just coincidentally end up at Baskin Robbins. He was just giving up. So it starts with the mindset. It's the mindset thing.
So if you're looking for a lie, you're going to find some stuff.
You're going to find it.
If you're expecting a lie, you're going to find some stuff that you think is a lie. Is that what we're saying?
Absolutely. That's exactly what I'm saying.
Got you. Let me go here. Let me go here. It has been said that women can't go back financially. And once you start whining, dining, they've experienced the finer things in life. They've taken trips and all of this stuff. You know, the next guy, they're expecting him to compete with the last. So they can't go back financially. But let me ask you this. Can men go back sexually?
Yeah.
Sexually?
Once she put it on him, once she blew his mind, once she changed the game on him, can he go back sexually?
Well, I can answer that. I believe that a man can go back. Now, check this out. I believe that a man can go back sexually and hear what I'm saying. First and foremost, let me say this. For us, and correct me if I'm wrong, gentlemen, sex mainly is really physical for us. It's more emotional for you all as women.
Correct.
Only emotional for us, depending upon who the woman is and what she means to us. Now,
correct.
Nothing. We could be with a female that's off the chain that we don't particularly care for, but her sex was a 10, okay? All kinds of tips and things of that nature. Then we get with somebody, right? And here's the thing. And this is just me. Let me just speak for myself. And let's say the sex is a 7, right? But this is a woman that I'm emotionally attached to. Because I'm emotionally attached to this woman, believe it or not, that kind of makes up the difference in the intimacy part of that 7 not really being a 7 because they're my feelings and my
emotions. My emotions, my soul, my heart is all involved.
Okay. So that's a game changer for you all mentally when your heart and your mind get involved, because sex is just physical. I don't think women can wrap their mind around that fully because it's so emotional for them. So in their minds, they're thinking they're constantly competing with your sexual past. A lot of women feel that way.
But here's the crazy part about this, Shine. Correct me if I'm wrong, fellas. For most men, right? Mm-hmm. At least the sex, and I hate to say it this particular way. If you're not in the relationship with the woman, at the end of the day, because it's physical for us, all we're looking for is an orgasm. Hear me. The purpose is the orgasm. What happens is we really don't care about who the vehicle is because we just want the orgasm, which is why it's so easy for men to sleep with multiple women because they're not attached to them emotionally. They're just looking for the outcome. Mm-hmm. Now, again, that changes when we become emotionally attached to a woman or to a woman. And then here's the crazy part about us as men. When we get emotionally attached to a woman, and fellas, help me out with this. Why we always want to claim that that's my stuff? I own that. That's me. That's mine.
That's an ego thing for us, man.
Even if you with multiple women, each one of them is yours.
You want to claim all of it.
We will do that. We will put that claim, that clout. Like, man, you know, it's almost like we got you branded on our chest.
Exactly. And,
hey, you know, once we get attached to you in that physical type of atmosphere, then, you know, we feel like, you know, we are chinchilla to everybody. You know what I mean? You know, we your Black Panther.
Right. Okay. So got the T'Challa mentality. Got you.
It's definitely physical, like he was saying, because you can take a man can go out and sleep with 5 different ladies that he don't have no emotional attachments to. But the one woman that he's in love with, she don't have to sleep with nobody. She can just exchange contact with somebody, and his heart would be broke.
Oh yeah,
like what are you doing?
Yeah.
I need your address. I got to send you an offer. You preaching?
Yes, sir. I'm finna join this, sir.
Let him use you.
Yeah, that's real, though. You know,
that's real, though, man. That's real, dude, what you just said.
Yeah, because, see, I remember times of being in love and if that, doing all kind of stuff in college and undergrad. I'm a cute dog. I'm living up to the reputation.
There it is.
But the one girl that I may have liked the most was doing the same thing I was doing. I just didn't know.
That's the real game changer. Well, if you find a woman who's cool with you being a hoe, she's right with you.
You're wilder than me. I mean, I would cheat on her and feel bad about cheating on her. And then when I found out she was cheating, I regretted the fact that, man, I spent all that time feeling guilty for nothing. He was doing the same thing.
Right.
Let me say hello to people watching that I can see because they're lumping it together. There's a lot of people tuning in. Felicia Johnson, Ajile Brown, Bernita Brown, Marie McMillan, Bob Sumner, what's up, homie? Stan Tunnel, Deb Davis, Jeff Allen III. Let me see. He says, you all are speaking the truth. He was like, men are definitely territorial. Women today try to carry it like men. What do you all say?
There's some out there that do that. Yeah. I mean, they out there.
What do you think about women who are like, why can't I do what men do?
Well, here's my thing. I'm a realist.
Okay.
And for me, my thought process is this. If I'm capable of doing these things, what makes me think that you're not capable?
You're not.
And here's the other thing. What makes me think that you're not capable of doing them even better?
Correct.
Probably.
Because here's the thing. Sometimes, depending upon who the woman is, we may even feel, I'm going to use this word, convicted and guilty, as Meek was saying, and perhaps we may even want to get to a point where we might want to share with that person and say, you know what, oh man, I messed up and I screwed up. But then you have that particular woman that's like, she going to the grave with hers. So
you can confess. You're the only one sharing.
You're the only one sharing, homeboy. Cause I'm not telling you nothing.
I ain't telling you nothing.
You ain't see me there? She's gonna be like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Right. You
know,
if you ain't see it, it didn't happen.
Tyrone Davis, baby. Tyrone Davis. If you didn't come up and touch me, it sure wasn't me. Let's got to know about the blues. You know what I'm talking about now.
JJ, I know about the blues.
Are women better at being sneaky than men, JJ?
Say again?
Are women better at being sneaky than men?
They are now.
They are now. It's a new game.
I think they caught us. I think they just overtook us. You know, back in the day, man, we used to be the Chicago Bulls running the thing. Now, these women now, they go to state. They going back to back to back. They got everything.
They got back to back championships.
They ain't just making the playoffs no more. Now they putting these teams together. They got LeBron. AD all on one team.
They didn't even go Jordan back in.
Oh yeah, women ain't playing.
They got 2-3 they got 2-3 Instagram pages.
Oh yeah,
you only know about the main page, the family pictures.
And we ain't gonna talk about the cold names they using now.
Well, hey,
they got COVID.
You go on the back page. They on Instagram like this.
Right.
Is that my baby mom?
You crazy.
Y'all are funny. But okay, so since we're on this vein, I'm gonna go back to something I talked to with I want to say it was maybe London Brown, HBO Bars, when he was on. We were talking about Donovan Jordan, that's what it was. Donovan Jordan and Evan Lionel. I asked the question, is monogamy a realistic expectation? What do you guys have to say? That's what they say. You can expect it. Should I keep moving? Should we go to another question?
No, I was going to wait on Robert he usually do the intro with a great way of setting it up.
He can't be just setting it up for y'all. Y'all got to jump in here. Because I know Randy is a wordsmith. He a songwriter. He know how to get the panties to drop.
He's
been writing songs for 30 years. He's been selling albums for 30 years.
He wrote songs about quickies.
We waiting on him to give an insurance answer.
I'm going to stop this right now. Randy cannot be your leader because he's the wrong one. Oh, that's JJ, his job to make women drop.
Let me say this, though.
Ask that question. JJ and Robert, they both look, they wives must be next to him because they both said.
You said in front of me.
You know, oh, I didn't mean to set y'all up.
I told you she was right here. No.
Right.
Well, okay. Let me clean it up.
No, no, you
okay.
You don't even have to clean it up. Let me say this.
No, you don't.
Let me ask you. First of all, there has to be a sense of maturity of the mind.
Yes.
Honestly, and control. So this, you have to be realistic with yourself. You know, one of the reasons why I will not cheat on my wife, and this is the truth, because you have to be honest with yourself. You got to know yourself, all right? And again, like I said, I'm 51. We don't have time to be playing these freaking games. Seriously, I'm a grown man. So here's the thing. I have to make sure that I don't put myself in situations where I'm tested, where I can fail the test. So, in other words, if I know that a female or two or three, I'm just saying, may be interested, why am I going to go to the hotel with these two and three women just so that we can go chit-chat? I'm a man. I didn't even like going to the strip clubs because I ain't like paying for the money and we ain't having sex. Now, I want you to get that money. But you understand what I'm saying? If I'm going to be in it, I'm in it. I'm either black or I'm white. There is no gray with me. So the bottom line for me is I had to make sure, one, that I'm mature to a place where so here's the thing. I have to look at the bigger picture versus what's in front of me at the moment. Because okay. What's in front of me at the moment can screw up what the bigger picture is as it relates to my purpose and my destiny. And I'm at a place in my life where I know that I'm on assignment. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. When I was younger, that stuff was cute, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. God kept me and he covered me. You know, I got burnt once in 86. You know what I'm saying? And thank God for those type of things. For medicine that got me well again, you know. But you have to be at a place where you have to say, you know what? Listen, I've traveled the world. How much more am I going to get? How much more do I really need at 50? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So you have to be at a place where you are, when you're in a relationship or marriage, because you don't even have to be married. When you're in a relationship and you're married, where you can say, you know what? Okay. It's not worth it. It's not worth the risk. Because I love the risk, but it's not worth the risk. I have too much to lose. You know what I'm saying?
That's the key word. I got a lot to lose.
But what do you say, JJ?
I mean, I just am feeding off him. I mean, I have too much to lose. I mean, you know, I built a very strong foundation with my wife, man, over the years. We've been married 14 years, but, you know, I've been after this woman since 1987.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So, I mean, I wouldn't jeopardize what I've done, put the work and the effort and the commitment that I've put into this marriage. And then I want to also set a great example for my son.
Okay.
My son is 15, so he's looking at us. He's paying attention on how we communicate and the things that we do around the house and everything, man. So I don't want him to think it's cool. I mean, you know, I told him to have his fun as a kid. Mm-hmm. Learn yourself. I told him to learn yourself. But I also want to make sure I set that example, like, man, this is what you want out of life. You can't continue to just play the field. And you got to show, like he said, you got to show some type of maturity growing up. I'm 51 as well. I didn't, you know, before marriage, yeah, I done had my fun, you know, and then I'm in the entertainment business and, you know, you have access to it.
It's a lot.
It's a lot. but I don't want to lose this for just a 5 minute or 10 minute type of fun. And, you know, not being able to have my son and my family around and everything, man. So, you know, me being older and mature and wiser and, you know, and committed to what I have, you know, it's not worth it.
Okay, let me ask you this, because you said something about their levels, you know, so you encourage your son to get to know himself, to explore, to, you know, do what he needs to do to become a man. So let me ask this. At what point do men become faithful if they're going to mature to that level? When does it happen? Does it happen while you're dating? Does it happen after you get married? Does it happen during engagement? When does that level of maturation happen for men?
Depends on the man.
Keep it real.
Depends on the object. Depends on the man.
Okay.
Depends on the man.
Memphis said, what? What'd you say, Memphis?
You got to keep in mind, he who finds a wife finds a good thing.
And faith.
Okay. So, okay.
Yeah, exactly. So, and she
did you
prepares
answer my
herself
question,
to be
though?
Fine.
I know the Bible verse, but did you answer
my
question?
I'm about to, I'm getting to it. I'm getting to it.
Okay.
I'm saying he Amen. Who finds a wife finds a good thing. She who prepares herself to be found can be found. So, okay. When a man finds his wife, I think it's at that point that he wants to be faithful. Like if you was listening to Robert and JJ, they were sounding like both of their wives had a 38 point in them. Because they gave them amazing answers.
Hey, cause so look, like, cause
right there. Right. The wives are right there.
Get it right. Get it right.
If you look closely, you can see the shadow. The wives are right there.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. I saw the pistol come in the camera at one point. They both gave amazing faithful answers.
Hey, because my wife know where my gun at, so I know.
Okay, so for this episode, we're going to change the title to It Most Likely Is What It Is. Because I don't know what y'all talking about. Most likely it is what it is. That's what this episode is.
Yeah, keep in mind when you asking your questions, they are definitely in front of their wives. So they give you, they give you textbook answers. I mean, you should have heard them. Robert come in, see what you want to do.
Thanks.
But you know what? It's the most beautiful thing to be faithful to, and don't go through temptation. JJ follow up with, I've been chasing mine since 1973. the doctor introduced us. We met at the hospital when we were both born, and the doctor introduced us and said, y'all gonna be together.
Pastor Memphis, you know what else though? The truth of the matter too is this, y'all. Even though my wife is sitting here, and I mean, we've had these conversations. We've had, you know, I also had to make sure that I watch what comes out of my mouth.
Okay.
When I
had to learn.
Because some things could be misleading. Mm-hmm. And because I am a songwriter and I can say some slick stuff out of my mouth, it could come across flirtatious and make a woman perceive me as I'm wanting her versus me giving a compliment.
So Randy, what about that? And fellas, this wasn't even on my list, but you said it. How do some women don't know when you're just being nice and being a gentleman. In their mind, they're already planning your wedding. All you did was be courteous to them. You understand what I mean? They're like, oh, we have some beautiful babies. They go all the way out there. What can you say to women to know that some men are just nice? Sometimes they just, you know, treat you like a queen, because so many women aren't used to it. So now you done smiled or winked at them and said, hello, beautiful. Now y'all go together. What is that?
It probably is just communication, the way you speak to her and you know, the things that you are saying to her. I mean, you know, she a grown woman. She should be able to read between the lines of, right, who's trying to holler and who just
but
trying
sometimes
to...
they can't.
Yeah, that's true.
Natural flirts.
That's true. Was, you know, I mean, some women, like, you know, that happened, you know, I had to let them know, like, look, and then I got my seed at the house already. And, you know, I don't know what I said to you to make you think that.
Okay.
For leading you in that manner and everything. But I already got some in the house, baby. I'm good.
Yeah, because, I mean, you all are entertainers. So you all travel the world, and a huge fan base in entertainment is women. Women drive the shows, you know, so men come see which women are going to be at the show. Exactly. So, I mean, part of your job, especially songwriters and singers and people like that, but also comedians, is to make people love you instantly. You got about 30 seconds when you hit that stage to make them love you. And yeah. So that's a natural gift for you. So it must be harder for you as entertainers to kind of curtail that when you're being nice to fans. You know, you're trying to keep your followership and women falling in love. You know, I see women all the time calling people their husband, you know, on Facebook and social media.
I think part of the thing, one of the things you could do, I know for me, I keep it moving. If I give a comment, I keep it moving. I don't give you time to entertain. I don't even really need you to respond. You know, I just keep, you know, your head looks pretty. Keep moving.
One thing I do to get out of that situation is at the end of the shows, when the girls come, you just be like, hey, thank you so much. Hey, you look beautiful. Now, hey, thank you so much. And then if I like them, I take my homeboy and let him swing back and go get the number for me. No,
I was like, you got a system.
I'm trying to put some season energy in it.
You got a system. Let me say hello to Crystal Monique.
Married man answers.
Let me say hello to Crystal Monique, comedian Terry Barton Gregg, and Desiree Williams. Thank you, loves, for joining. Go ahead. Did I miss somebody? Can y'all hear me? Did I miss somebody?
Yeah, no, we can hear you.
Okay, good. Okay, well, let me try to see where I can slide to. what do you all feel about, since we've brought up marriage and things of that nature, and you all have been married for a long time, how do you all feel about prenups, though? And if you had to do it all over again, and you're already famous, if you're already famous when you meet your wives, how would you feel about prenups? You know what I mean? Because that sounds like you all met them at the, you know, beginning or the infancy or the development of your careers, or even before you even thought about what your career was going to be. So if you met them after you became famous, how do you feel about prenups for, you know, guys who are just starting out, but they're on the fast track to celebrity?
I would agree with a prenup, because like, if you grinding with me now and you down on my team now, and like you said, I think both of those guys met their wives in the, you know, the beginning stage of it. He said 1987 for JJ. So to me, that's like bread and butter. You know, that's like good old cornbread and collard greens.
It is.
When you got your wife.
And no jiffy. That's from scratch. Yeah,
exactly. Real cornbread.
Yeah, it's real. I got real cornbread upstairs.
Yes, sir. With black eyed peas, when you smash it up in there.
My wife is eating cornbread with real flour with meal.
Yes, sir. And so, but in my situation, like the lady I'm dating now will love both of them. But she was like, yeah, hang around both of them. Quit hanging around single people. Hang around both of those married men, because she loves their answers, trust me. And she going to get on me for talking about the single stuff. Yeah, you in the club sending your homeboy to get the girl's number for real. I'm going to have to answer to that once I get off of Zoom. But I had to keep the podcast where we get some single man answers.
Right. You're just keeping it real. This is not testimonials. So let me put the disclaimer out. This is not testimonials. They just saying how men think. How men think.
But if a woman, to answer your question, if a woman wasn't there and you already successful and you have already made it, I believe in prenup, because is so many women with an agenda and a motive that they become Oscar winners. I mean, they become Oscar winners.
Yes.
And I be tripping on these celebrity guys that go out and marry these ladies, and I'd be like, man, that lady wouldn't have had nothing to do with you if you weren't who you were.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So,
no way.
So just stay within your lane. Stay in your circle. Who would date you if you didn't have nothing?
But then let me ask you this, Memphis, since you brought that up. At some point, do they even care? Do they know what the game is? When they reach a certain level and they just want a certain look or a certain accessory, a piece of arm candy, whatever, do they even care about love and commitment and longevity? Are they not? They just charge it to the game. At some point, do some people, men, even care? Some of the women clearly don't, because they're professionals. So, and when you get to that level, you know what I mean? They know what it is.
Yeah. Every man, no matter whether you're billionaire or whether you flatline, every man desire deep down inside, whether he hide behind the celebrity light or whatever, every man wants to be with a woman that loves him for him at the end of the day. And so all these guys that run around, I see the celebrities be sometimes having multiple girls, and they be bad women too. But ultimately, I see through it, and I can see that hole in their heart.
Yes.
Although they go on all the vacations, all the trips, all the beautiful women. I mean, they got it so good that the women are all agree to be their girlfriends. You know, it'd be four women running with one guy.
Whole squad.
But that man, you be looking at that man thinking on the outside looking in, like, man, I wish I was him. Man, he got four, five girls. They all get along, da-da-da-da-da. But actuality, he got a dark spot in his heart. You know, he's really still lonely.
Right.
You can be lonely inside of a packed room.
Right.
That's
so
true.
So you still feel lonely at the end of the day. So you want somebody to love you for you at the end of the day, because if those ladies are there because of your money, then guess what? When that money gone or you get sick, they gone. You ain't got nobody to
out of there.
No. Nobody to help you do nothing. Right. So they basically temporary ladies. You have to maintain your career life. And you can't introduce them to nobody more successful than you because they opportunity. Yeah.
But they'll be gone.
They part of the game.
Oh, they gone. So
they gonna escalate.
They gone. They opportunities.
Are men afraid of losing everything at the end of the day? Like, especially when you get married and you commit. And if you are on that level or you're climbing, are they afraid of losing everything? Because I've seen a lot of men lose everything several times, you know, and they try it again. I'm like, slow down. But are men afraid of losing everything?
Yeah.
Their kids, their money, their house, their everything. You know what
absolutely.
I mean?
I think men are afraid of losing things, but at the same time, depending on the type of man and his grind, he's willing to start all over and do what it is that he needs to do to get where it is that he's striving to be. As long as he can, you know, make moves and has the mentality of doing better and being and seeing beyond his circumstance, you know, if he has that type of vision, especially if he's a man of vision, you know, he's gonna keep it moving no matter who's riding, who's not with him. What he has, what he doesn't have, you know, he's gonna keep it pushing. And once we answer this question, I got a question for the table.
Okay.
Anybody else want to answer that question?
Anybody?
Yeah, I'm ready.
I did Pastor Ari speak for y'all? Pastor Randy already spoke for y'all. I know he's still your leader. I see y'all.
I know. I'm afraid to lose everything and everything. So that's why, you know, I continue to bust my ass and grind and continue to try to create and build branches off this tree that I've already, you know, been growing for over these years and everything. So, you know, we being this entertainment business, you know, it can be up and down sometime and, you know, it can go down the dead ends and everything, but you got to learn how to turn around and get back on that right road and find another direction and everything, man. So, you know, I still got that grind, that hunger, even though I've been doing stand-up for 25 years, you know, I'm not settling for where I am. You know, I continue to strive and continue to be successful and create. Even during this pandemic, you know, I was able to be blessed enough to survive it still being creative and trying to, you know, bring in different ways of other income and everything, man. Because I was sitting telling my son back when it first started, you know, we don't know when we're coming out of this.
Mm-hmm.
We really don't know when we're coming out of this. You know, the world kind of semi-opened up a little bit. You know, I've been doing a few comedy clubs here and there during the pandemic and everything, but it's not like I'm not doing arenas right now, theaters.
Right.
Nothing like that, man. So, you know, I got to keep telling him that, you know, I got to still continue to bring in income and continue to create and you know, be able to provide for him, man. So, you know, I'm hoping, you know, he understand that and, you know, and follow my footsteps and get that mentality to grind himself.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Randy, you said you had a question.
Yeah, I wanted to know how, from the black male's perspective, I mean, I have mine, but I just wanted to know from my brothers, how do you feel? Because to me, I believe this is kind of where we are in life a little bit.
Okay.
Outside of, and I'm saying for the average man, that's outside of entertainment or things of that sports, things of that nature, for the average black man, how do you think we are handling our spouses or girlfriends or counterparts being more financially successful and stable than what we are? Because a lot of men can't handle a woman making more money than them.
I believe it depends on that particular man. You know, I'm a confident man. I don't have a problem with a woman making more money than me. and everything, you know, I feel like, you know, I'm gonna still bring in my part regardless. Mm-hmm. You know, it may not be six figures or high-end money that you bringing in, but as long as I'm not sitting on my ass and just holding on to your car right. while you at work or playing PlayStation all goddamn day, and I come pick you up and your car right. smells like weed and I ain't putting no gas in the car and I'm not taking care of right. I'm going to be doing something. I'm not just going to be sitting right. there laying up all day and then you come home and I'm going to tell you what happened on TMZ today.
Wow. You know, girl, you know, should see more.
No, I'm definitely gonna do my part, man, because you know I can't have a woman to look down on me like I got a deadbeat dude that's not doing nothing. He's not even putting that effort in. Even if it's just, you know, you 9 to 5 making minimum wage, man, at least you putting that effort in. You know, you're not just letting your mm-hmm. wife carry or your girlfriend carry you, and you know, like you wearing an apron all goddamn day. So you know,
right?
You know, it depends on that individual man that. You know, if you can handle that, you know, it shouldn't be no problem at all.
Right. I agree with JJ. I think if you doing what, like JJ said, meaning if the man is out grinding, he's doing some, then it comes down to the woman as well. Don't treat him like he's less than, because at the end of the day, when God knock on that door, he's asking for the men of the house. Mm-hmm. You want to talk to the alpha, because that's the mm-hmm. that's the head of the household, that alpha. So. Yeah. You're dealing with a young lady that has an understanding of, yes, I make the most figures, but my figures I make is a team effort for the better of our household and our family. But if you're dealing with the female with the mentality of, I'm going to remind him that he make lesser than me, then that's a woman. Those are the women that I feel like they think, oh, guys, they find me intimidated. No, they don't find you intimidated. They find you insulting because you mm-hmm. continue to yeah. insult them. So right. you're not single because you make a 6 figures and 7 figures job. You're single because how you're treating people that was, you might meet a nice guy that don't make as much as you make, but he treated you like a queen, and you're not making him feel like a king. So right. Forget your income. Take your income and do exactly what the man would do, which is he take his income, whether he make more or less, and he invest it in the household for the best of the household. Mm-hmm. So don't make him feel less than or remind him that you make more money. You know, man, I pay for everything around here. Don't do that.
Because that was a conversation in the barbershop last week when I was there. So okay. I was saving that for my thought process. You know, and my wife makes more money than me anyway, but I'm just simply saying, I listened to some of the stuff that the guys were saying, and I was like, wow, are we really thinking like that? I mean,
right.
You know, now those that are being treated like that, I understand, but the ones that's not, I was like, wow, I can't believe our mindset is men, black men, we really being small-minded right now and just ignorant.
Right, right.
One of our viewers, Kiana Butler Roberts, says it shouldn't be equal contribution. It should be equal effort. So the effort outweighs the contribution. And so that's what she's saying. Moving on, let me, I'm rounding the corner on this show. The show usually lasts about 1:15, 1:20. Women always have a long list of deal breakers. I ain't putting up with that. What's the final straw in a deal breaker for a man?
Yeah. Respect.
At the end of the day, it's all about the respect factor. Because you could listen to me, a real man, and this is what I've come to learn. Even a homeless man, you can't be disrespect. He's not going to allow you to
disrespect him. Disrespect right. him, yes.
Mm-hmm. He's not going to allow you to disrespect him, even with nothing. So at the end of the day, because here's the thing. If you respect me, I believe that you'll love me as well. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have any respect for me at all, then we have a problem.
We're going to have a problem. And it ain't going to work at all without no respect at all.
Respect. Okay. Let me ask this. Since this show is basically 99 problems, just things men deal with on a regular basis, what are the biggest stressors that men face? What are your sources of frustration, whether it's life, relationships, in general? What is a problem for men you know, what's the big stressor for men?
Just men in general, or just men in a relationship?
It could be men in general, like, because we're talking about 99 problems and the things that men face and they deal with even silently sometimes. What is it that men are really, really puts the stress on them, frustrates them?
I mean, for me, I mean, you know, what frustrates me, there ain't no frustration. I would just say I am more concerned about not being able to continue to provide.
Okay.
I just want to continue to provide for my family, make sure my son is raised in the right manner and headed in the right direction. I just continue to want to make sure I have a roof over my head and clothes on his back, and clothes on my family back. And, you know, just, you know, that everyday stress, I mean, that thinking of, you know, how, where's the next meal coming from and how I'm going to make sure I continue to keep this roof on my head. I mean, for me, that's my thing right there. I just want to continue to provide and set that great example for my family and my son, you know, to, you know, I want to hold my head up to them and make sure they're proud of what I'm doing and what I'm trying to do for them. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Myself, I think the biggest thing is, I believe that as men, the three things that we're supposed to do is love, provide, and protect.
Yes.
What frustrates me is if I'm in a situation or a season in my life where I feel like I'm not able to do all three at the max because of lack of, for some particular reason, whatever the reason may be.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When we can't love the way we want to love, when we can't provide for the people that we want to provide for.
Provide for, yes.
Can't protect the people the way that we want to protect them. There's something about us, our spirit, that can be disappointing. And the last thing we want to do really is to be a disappointment, not only to ourselves, but to the people that mean the most to us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I pretty much 100% agree with both of them, because me, still groundbreaking comedian, you know, getting my feet in the door, got a few credits, but, you know, a long way to go. I was not working a 9-to-5 job. So I was only dependent on my comedy gigs, which I haven't made it to a household name yet to where I'm in demand. And my comedy income is consistent, because you got some household names, and still the income can be slow sometime. Well, you don't know. You know what I mean?
That's what the general public doesn't know.
Yeah, they don't.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they don't know that part. And so, because people can see a few television credits and just assume a person is all the way on. But long story short, my son was living in the living room with him and his mama was living in a living room at their grandmama's house in a one bedroom. And he told me, and I was living in a storage unit, you know what I mean? And he told me, he said, he was 4 years old. He said, I would like to have my own room one day. And let me tell you something. When I tell you that broke my entire spirit, it brought tears to my eyes when I got in my car. And guess what? I went and got a 9-to-5, and God told me I can work and still do my comedy until I become a household name to where I don't have to work my 9-to-5. So thank God I went and got my 9-to-5, because like you said, a man don't work, a man don't eat. So faith without work is dead anyway. Yeah. So I was blessed to not only get my son his own room, but my daughter got her own room as well. So now when I want my two kids to be in position to say, hey, I got my own room at my daddy's house. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's because I get up in the morning and I go to work. You know what I mean? And then I come back and I do my comedy. So going back to what JJ and Robert were saying, it's nothing like not being able to provide. When my son looked me in the eyes and said, I want my own room, it broke my spirit. And yet it was a wake up call. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? So I was like, you know what? Let me get myself together. Let me get on my grown man stuff. I studied just, hey, I'm out here doing comedy. I'm a comedian. Yeah, I am. But at the same time, God blessed me with common sense too. And so I went and got a job, and now I'm in position to be able to provide for my kids and myself. So that's the blessing for me.
Amen, brother.
Crystal Monique says, you guys are great men and great examples. Alana, they're enjoying your this broadcast and hearing what you all have to say.
Thank you.
rounding the corner. This is my next to last. What did you say, Ben?
Cash App.
So yeah, Cash App is coming through. See, we all need Cash App. We've been in this thing for months now, sitting home. But my next to last question is, it's 1 week away from Election Day. And given the climate of everything that has happened in this country, just in the last 2-3 years, I'm not even talk about historically, just in the last 2-3 years, 2-3 months, what does it feel like to be a Black man in America right now?
Scary. It is. I mean, it's definitely, we've been going through it for years and everything, man, but you know, 2020 has just been a real devastating year for us, man, pandemic-wise, and then being a Black man, you know, we really been going through it. We fed up, as you can see, as a race and everything, man. So, you know, what's going on with our Black men right now, man? You know, I tell my son every day, man, you know, just be careful of your surroundings. Be careful who you hang with, man. You know, I'm teaching him how to handle different situations as far as, you know, because he's at that age now that he's, you know, he about to get the car and mm-hmm. be going on his own and everything, man. So, you know, I got to make sure he understands what it means to be a Black man, what it also means to be a Black man in this society today. And that we've been going through this for years. And I need to make sure he understands that this is not nothing new. That we've been going through this for years and everything, man. So that's why me and my wife, we make sure we sit him down constantly and school him on about being a human being and a Black man in this society, man. And, you know, even though he's not old enough to vote, I made sure he sat down and listened to a lot of these presidential debates, and I make sure he watched the world news. And, you know, we ask him questions from time to time, man, just, you know, like, you can't TikTok every goddamn day, dude.
Right.
You know, you can't Snapchat and Fortnite and that. I mean, you know, that's fun. I want you to be a kid and have fun, man. But you got to also understand, man, that, you know, we're in a crazy world right now. And unfortunately, it don't seem like it's getting any better. And we're trying to strive to get better and everything, man. So, you know, we're in scary times right now. But I hold my head up. I'm proud to be a Black man. I feel like we're going to one day overcome this situation and everything, man. You know, I believe. That's why I made sure my voice was heard. I already voted. My name is Jeremiah Jr. And, you know, my dad is a senior. I want to go use his goddamn name again. I want to go try to vote twice. I go to jail for to vote twice and everything, man. So, you know, it's just scary times, man. But, you know, we got the man upstairs in our lives, man. You know, like I said, we're gonna continue to move forward and hold up, and hopefully we'll move over from this.
JJ, my son named Jeremiah.
Oh, is that right? Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For those just tuning in, the question was, what does it feel like to be a Black man in America right now?
I go so the wordsmith can close us out. Because I think he got a Black Panther speech waiting. Hey, but my thing is, I want for myself and other Black men, and from no matter what age they are, is to learn how to cope when being in the right. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is, we have to master our coping skills, because being right and being dead don't go together. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So you can be in the right, and the police officer or whomever can be in the wrong, but have the mentality of coping skills to be able to maneuver through whatever, although you're in the right, we know you're right. But if you see that this police officer is in the wrong and they continue to be aggressive or whomever, have the knowledge to cope and maneuver so you can be alive. And then
ain't nothing like fighting just as alive than just as dead. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? If you're alive, you can tell the story better than anybody that witnessed it, if you're alive. Mm-hmm. And so my thing is just learn how to cope even when you're in the right, because what happens is, as Black men, you know, our drilling get the pumping, especially when we're in the right. You know, when Black folks right, boy, it's hard to tell them to be quiet. Yeah. When they know they're right. In the right.
Uh-huh, right.
But being right and being dead don't go together. So even when you're in the right, you still have to have the knowledge to cope so you can maneuver through whatever's inappropriate behavior taking place so you can come back and then correct the situation while you're alive. If that make any sense. So my thing to the Black man is, Black man, let's cope. Let's cope out here. Let's not take our strong belief in being right and just continue to go down a direction that's getting us killed. Make it out the situation alive and then gather up an army and march and go to justice. And that's what this police officer did, or that's what this person did. Be alive. So if you have to humble yourself to stay alive, do just that. But it's been so many. I know y'all see the same videotapes I see. It's so many resistance arrests. And they have their right to be resisted, guys. But let's just face it. If we cope and stop resisting and go and get in the handcuffs and go and get put back in the police car, go and go get processed and booked in and booked out, how many of our Black men would still be alive if they didn't just resist? They was in the right. They didn't have to get out their car. They didn't have to get snatched out the car and dragged. They was in the right. But if you see that's what the police trying to do, he violating your rights. Mm-hmm. He's violating everything that the country, he ain't going by no laws. Well, stay alive. And then when you get out, then you're going to get a lawyer. Then you can start the process. Hey, this guy made me get out of my car. He didn't have my permission. He didn't tell me why he pulled me over. Then you can fight. But when you standing on your right, I'm right. I ain't got to get out of my car. I ain't got to do this. I ain't got to do that. That's not coping. Although you're right, that's not coping. That leads to a lot of people end up getting killed. And I'm tired of seeing my Black brothers being resisted and getting killed, although they're in the right. Being right shouldn't equal out to being dead, to prove your point.
Randy, what does it feel like to be a Black man in America right now?
Well, basically, to add on to what they've said, it's really scary. And the sad part about it is, although I've spoken with my son quite a few times about this issue, it's not even about the Black young man. At this particular time in the world today, all you have to do is be a Black male. The age really doesn't even matter. And so one of the things that I really think that we should begin to focus on is it's not just a scary, here's the thing, it's not just a scary thing as it relates to police. It's also a scary thing as it relates to Black on Black crime as well. You know, and so at the end of the day, I'm begging, charging all of our Black men that are fathers and father figures to continue, or if you're not, to begin to pour into some of these other Black men and young boys so that, they can begin to have an outlet, a positive outlet, if you will, so that some of the situations that they end up in, they won't even have to necessarily be addressed by the police because they won't be in certain situations. And a lot of that has to do with sometimes our foundation and the way that we're raised. One of the things that I do know is this: God does things in decency and in order. Mm-hmm. And God's plan for us to be, listen to this real quick and I'm gonna get out of here. When we were birthed, God's plan was for us to be boys that became men, that became husbands, that became fathers. And what we've done, some of us, I can speak for myself, I was a boy that became a father, that then became a husband, that then became a man. That's not the order. And so there were so many stresses of life that I put on myself based upon the choices that I made. There were so many things that I was up against, even with the police, based upon the choices that I made and not necessarily being directed, if you will, in the right order to do things. Now, some of us are directed there. Some of us, we just do what it is that we want to do. And so as a Black man, I'm just asking us to try to do better with our community. We know that they're going to always try to put their knee on our neck. I pray that that changes. It's something to me that a lot of them, not saying all of them, but it's something that it's enough of them that take pleasure in treating us the way that they treat us. And we have to know our value, and we have to know that we are kings. You know, we are kings and queens. And so therefore we have to begin to act like it, present ourselves that way, and treat each other that way, and not take each other out as well. So, you know, it's scary, but I stay prayed up. And I believe that, you know, I believe that God is not going to allow me to go until my assignment is complete, because I refuse to die with any ounce of purpose left in me.
Okay.
Hey, I'm glad we just had that conversation. Look who getting that knowledge real quick.
Hey, love. You better listen up.
Yeah, listen to this, man. So, you know, I'm glad he sat. He heard us talking and everything, man. And you know, it must have registered in him, man. He just sitting down here, just ain't saying nothing, just listening.
Yeah. That's a beautiful thing. And all of you all have such amazing spirits. And I've been praying. And my last question is coming up, how I close out every show. But I've been praying every episode that every episode gets better. You know, and so I've just, for 25 years, I've been listening to God in divine order and how to treat people and how to handle business and how to even do this show. And so the personalities always mesh, even when I put strangers together. So I know that's divine order. And so I have enjoyed you guys. And let me ask my final question. This is how I close out every show. What is something you wish women understood or knew about men?
A lot. How about that?
How about this?
Well, just give me one.
Men would love to be able to be vulnerable and transparent to a woman that they know they can trust, that has their back, and that will support them in the vision and dreams that God has given them.
Mm-hmm.
And trust them.
For me, just I wish women would just, you know, stop putting us in the doghouse for years of other men doing certain things, man. You know, everybody ain't like that, ladies. You know, I mean, it's okay to give somebody else a chance and an opportunity to show what type of person they are, man. You ain't got a dog every, just because you got a dog in this one, that the man right there did that, don't mean that next man is gonna do that. Because I remember one time, somebody was telling me one time, I heard somebody say, you know, that's why I don't trust no man. That's why I don't trust no woman. Like, mm-hmm. don't put that man, whatever situation you was in, don't mean that next man is going to do you like that, man. So, you know, have confidence and believe in that person who, especially if you're really interested in, and you know, you feel like he's really going to be there for you.
I would say two better than one, ladies. So, let me tell you something. If you want to, because most ladies want to be with a king. Well, if you want a man to feel like he can conquer the world, believe in him. Just believe in him and support him and get behind him. And let me tell you, he will become the king that God meant for him to be. You know, and if you his soulmate and the one that's supposed to be with him, then it's y'all job to support each other, but as that queen of the house, as the common of the house, even when that man feel like he's failing, you make him believe he's conquering.
Right.
Because if he believes it, long as he believes it, he can really conquer the world. So make sure you keep him believing.
Are all hearts and minds clear?
Yeah, where do I send my
offering? You said what now, babe?
Where do I send my offering to Pastor?
Well, you can send it to me. I'm in charge of finance. And we're gonna disperse it among the brethren.
Absolutely.
But let me give my closeout takeaways as always. In terms of communication, and are men liars? If you don't want the truth, then don't ask. And in terms of monogamy, the benefits outweigh the risk. And so if they are focused on you, they're committed to you, then they're always going to look at the benefit over the risk of losing you and everything that they've worked so hard to attain. As far as what's important to men, respect is paramount. That has been the driving theme throughout tonight. And the biggest fear, not being able to be a provider. And so, and not be able to take care and love the people that they love. And when you ask a Black man, how does he feel in America right now? The goal is to stay alive. And if you want your relationship to grow, nothing trumps believing in him and making him feel like he can do anything. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate you all for joining me tonight. I thank my guests, Randy Roberts, Memphis Will, JJ Williamson. I thank my producer, Corey Marshall, my content editor, Jen Watts. I thank you all for tuning into the sixth episode of It Is What It Is. And we will not have a show next week on Election Day because I need y'all to focus. Yes. As I need you to get to the polls. We haven't already. Yes. Focus. Yes. And so, get we are not having a show. Yes. Exactly. Yeah, and we are not having a show on November 3rd. We will return with an all-star lineup. And the next 5-6 shows are going to be fire. So you need to stay in tune. It's going to keep getting better and better and better. We will be back November 10th, Tuesday, November 10th. We resume It Is What It Is with the 7th episode. And we'll have B. Cole out of Chicago. We'll have Kyle Irby from the Cheryl Underwood Show. And we'll have Damon Williams, legendary comedian. And then coming up later in the month, we'll have Rodney Perry. And Marcus D. Wiley, you know him from the Elon Downs Morning Show. We'll also have Ron G., HBO's Insecure, with his cute self. And talent will be here. Also, Mark Vieira and Raheem Devon is coming through. So you all stay tuned with me. And we're going to have some great shows coming up. And so I'm Charmel McMillan. It is what it is, how men think. Every Tuesday, 8 p.m., join us back November 10th for another great show. Thank you. God bless you. You all have a great night.
Hey, man. Thank you so much, man.
How about breaking positive energy?
Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you. Platform. So I like this. This is real nice.
Thank you. I appreciate you.
I truly enjoyed this, man. Bring me back again.
I will. Thank you all. I love you all. And I appreciate all of your support and all of that. And it was a good show. And thank you all for sharing your hearts and what you're thinking for real. And I know it's a blessing to people. We had a good